Welcome to another episode of Light Cellar Radio. My name is Malcolm Saunders, helping you recreate relationship to food, accessing the ultimate in everyday nourishment through natural foods. On today's episode, very important topic, what happens when you introduce fermented foods? It makes your symptoms worse. I had special guest expert Deborah Morgan of Kids Health Revolution on the show to talk about why that happens, two reasons, as well as what you can do about that. Listen in. This was a Facebook Live that we did, and I think you're going to enjoy it. All right, we are live. Welcome everyone to the broadcast. We are answering a very important question, hot topic, because I know somebody watching, and I hope it's, I don't hope it's you.
No. Unfortunately. But if it is you,
we have answers. And if you know someone, make sure you forward this to them, because fermentation, we love it, right? There's such a hype around it. Probiotics, fermented foods, it is absolutely fantastic. But sometimes it doesn't always work, right? Someone, maybe it's you, if you've been watching this, introduce fermented foods with all this fervor, all this excitement, like, woo, this is going to be the best ever, right? I can't believe my digestion's going to improve. This is going to happen.
I'm going to feel great.
And then, uh-oh, right? Either don't feel the benefits, or worse, it makes symptoms even worse. So what happened? What went on there? That's what we're gonna be answering, along with what you can do about it. Steps to get yourself in the right direction to make sure it does work for you, because there are so many benefits to fermented foods, to these probiotics that do get talked about. It is for good reason, and if it hasn't worked for you, then this is the interview for you to listen to. So we've got guest expert Deborah Morgan of Kids Health Revolution. She's on Facebook as Kids Health Revolution and on Instagram as Kids Health Rev.
So I have a couple of waves over there.
Yeah, I got some waves. Yeah, awesome, cool. So if you're just joining us, post some comments down below. If you have a question, yeah, type them down. This is your opportunity to learn from Deborah Morgan. It's not your only opportunity. You can give her a follow on Kids Health Revolution, on the social channels, as well as she's one of our guest experts that's speaking tomorrow at the Calgary Fermentation Festival. And yeah, what a ride it's been. We've been doing lots of live videos. You and I tried to do this.
Yes.
Was it last week, 10 days ago?
Yeah, technology.
It took us three attempts and finally we're like, this isn't working. So we're back today to answer this very important question of what happened? I added in ferments and it made my symptoms worse. It's not too all uncommon. So if you're watching this, you're like, oh, it's me, you know, like poor me. Mm. Deborah's gonna share a little bit of insight on what went wrong and then the two things you can do about that as well. So again, comments, questions, post it down below, share it with those.
Fern's online, she says hello from McDonald's.
Hey Fern, welcome. Fern. Yeah, thanks for joining us. Yeah, we are about to dive in here. And yeah, this has all been leading up to Calgary Fermentation Festival happening tomorrow here in Calgary. I believe, how many tickets you said left?
17.
17, that's
wow.
It, out of 150.
Amazing.
It's gonna be an amazing day. I mean, literally, for the price of one workshop, you get to come all day, have samples, learn 15 different experts, five sessions. Yeah, it's gonna be awesome, including your presentation. What are you gonna be speaking on tomorrow?
I'm talking about minding your microbiome, so helping people learn a little bit more about what their microbiome does for them, because we don't actually often think about the gut bugs that live in our tummy when we think about living our ideal life, right? We might think about heart health because we hear so much about that, right?
Yeah.
Or we might think about bone health because we hear so much about that. But nobody talks about how important those little critters living in our tummies are to actually living all the things that we want to do in our lives. So I'm going to talk about how important they are and then what you can do. And we'll also touch a little bit on if you happen to have any health issues, how you might take some of the gut health recommendations a little bit further to help you improve your health so you can live that ideal life.
Yeah, totally. So this is an area and expertise of Deb's that she's been studying for quite a while, helping clients, you know, not only through workshops, but also one-on-one as well.
Yes.
Kind of that hand-holding, step-by-step, customized approach. You're certified in different modalities as well?
Yep. So I'm certified as a GAPS certified GAPS practitioner, just blanked on the name of it there for a minute. So that's the gut and psychology syndrome diet by Dr. Natasha Campbell-McBride, as you know, and then as well, just sort of specialized in gut health in general. So that's the majority of people that I work with and help them just walk through those steps of implementing the changes, right? Because a lot of people know they need to make changes, and they might even know what changes they need to make because it's all out there, right?
Yeah.
Lots of information on it, but actually putting it into practice is where a lot of people struggle. So
for
that's
sure.
really how
and especially
people.
When it comes to children, right?
Yes.
Which is an area that you focus on, and you can help mothers, you know, yeah. with their, or individuals with their own journey. But really when it comes to, you know, working with our children, if they are challenged with their microbiome, with their health, mm-hmm. You've really got a system to help them.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. And it's born out of your journey and your experience doing this yes. for yourself and your son.
Right on, yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Awesome. Cool.
Yeah.
All right, so let's get into this. We've got reason number one. You introduced ferments into your diet and it made your symptoms worse. What happened?
What went wrong?
All right.
Okay, so the first thing is, the first thing to consider is die-off, right? So
right.
we've heard this term, what is die-off? So sometimes when we go out and we hear, oh, great, fermented foods are the thing, right?
Right.
Like we talked about, that's what I need. And we go out, we come to the light cellar, or we make our own big batch of pickles or sauerkraut or whatever. And then we kind of go crazy, right? We have a whole bunch of it because
more is better,
right?
Right.
And what can happen is when we have an imbalance in the gut bugs that live in there, so we have more of the pathogenic and opportunistic bacteria in there.
Right, the candida, those
right,
types of
things. Candida, yeah, even C. difficile and some of these guys can be in there without us knowing it. So if you have any digestive issues and that's the reason you're turning to fermented foods, it's very likely that there's some sort of dysbiosis, we call it, a little imbalance in the gut bugs in there. So suddenly, it's like the good guys and the bad guys. And when I talk to kids about it, I like to use a Star Wars analogy. So I talk about the bad guys as being like the Sith, if anybody's ever watched Star Wars.
Just follow along.
The bad guys,
that.
Just stick with me. And then suddenly we introduce all these good guys, all these Jedi come in, and they start crowding out the bad guys. They start to try and push them out. Well, those bad guys don't want to go.
No, for sure.
Right? They are intelligent.
It becomes like gang wars.
Right, yes. It's going on in your intestine.
Yeah.
So that's part of the reason that sometimes you'll take all of this really good stuff but feel worse because of this battle that's going on in your gut. And the die-off is happening too fast.
Right.
So those guys, as they're dying, they produce different metabolic products that are quite toxic to the body.
Yeah.
So that's why we can get flu-like symptoms
totally.
And
headaches
even fevers
and
chills and vomiting and diarrhea and all kinds of crazy stuff can happen when we push that dye off a little too fast.
Totally.
So,
and just like we talk about, you know, the benefits of the microbiome and all these good probiotics, like, you know, they can influence our mood because when those good guys, when they own the place, when they're like thriving, right, they're producing serotonin, they're producing all these like wonderful good things.
Right.
But if you've got the Sith Lords and the dark side down there.
Right, the dark sides, yeah.
Right? You know, you're not getting those good neurotransmitters, but you're getting all these bad chemicals too,
right?
And that can be a really reason why you can be like, you know, depressed mood and all this stuff. And so The battle ensues.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, I'm going to make a movie. So talking about that balance, and if we've got the Sith are up here, the bad guys are kind of like this, and they're producing, not only are they interfering with the production of those neurotransmitters, but they can also be sending brain signals or chemical signals to the brain to increase inflammation.
Right.
Because inflammation is also helping them to thrive.
Totally.
So they are creating an environment for themselves that supports their survival. They are intelligent.
Yeah, right.
And so we need to just be a little bit more intelligent than them when it comes to trying to take them out of the equation.
No, for sure. And then they can influence, you know, like your mood, like you're saying, but also cravings.
Oh, for sure.
Right? Like big sugar, time. Like who, you know, like I remember going through nutrition school and learning about this concept like years ago. And at that time, like total sugar addict, right? Mm-hmm. Like my diet wasn't good. There was some number of factors, but I used to always joke. It's like, oh, that's my candida talking, right?
Yeah, right.
You know, it's my candida wants the sugar.
Totally wants the sugar.
Yeah. I'm
feeding my candida.
Right? Yeah. But it's part of it. So, yeah. All right. If you're just joining us, we've got Deborah Morgan here of Kids Health Revolution. We are talking about that very important topic that many people face. It's probably more than you realize. If you're watching, you're like, oh, it was just me. Ferments didn't work for me. Mm-hmm. It can happen to a lot of people. The two reasons why, maybe initially when you start to consume fermented foods, it doesn't work or the symptoms become worse. So Deborah's just shared the first number one reason, which is this idea of die-off, right? So when you have that imbalance of bacteria, you start to add the good to what is a predominant train of the bad.
Right.
Then a little battle ensues, mm-hmm. right? They're fighting for control. You're going to get die-off of the good and the bad, you know, in that kind of warfare that's going on down there.
And it's a bit of a storm, right?
Right.
Yeah, and your collateral damage.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so how can we avoid that first one?
Right. So the real ticket here is to start slow.
Yeah.
So, you know, don't eat 4 pickles in a day, your first day.
Right. Or a giant bottle of kombucha.
Right. Or, yes. Yeah. And that's a really common one because that's such an available thing for people now, which is fantastic. But then people hear about it and go out and drink the kombucha and think, oh no, I can't drink kombucha.
Yeah.
Well, actually you might be able to, but you just need to start a little bit slower.
Yeah.
So really depending on the person will dictate and what's going on with your health is going to dictate how slowly you need to go. So sometimes when I work with people, we need to start with just taking, you know, a half a teaspoon of the juice from your sauerkraut or your pickles or some kombucha or yogurt or whatever it is, just a tiny little bit every day. And then noticing how your symptoms are and keeping, you know, fairly close track of how you're feeling, even if you don't have a chronic health condition, but you have tried them before and noticed it wasn't good. Well, now try them again, but slowly, and just, you know, maybe every night take a little note about how you're feeling that day.
Yeah.
And if there was some symptoms, if there was some more gas or bloating or something like that, then you just stay at that half a teaspoon for a little while.
Yeah.
And then, you know, 3 or 4 days, maybe a week, again, depending on how much imbalance is in there. And then you start slowly increasing it up.
Yeah.
Like titrating it, right? Little by little, and measuring what's working for you. And eventually you'll get to the place where you're able to handle more and more. Because what's happening there is where the die-off is starting to happen, but not such a rapid firestorm happening in there.
Because the good guys always win, right?
Of
just
course.
Like in the movies and Star Wars, right? It's like once that battle happens, like good prevails.
Yes, that's right.
And they will turn over that terrain, but they do need some help. So as you're just sharing this idea of, you know, slowly that way, we also need to kind of reset the terrain that they're living in.
Absolutely.
Like, there's actually no point, you know, throwing probiotics down the hatch and all these fermented foods if you don't change your diet,
right?
In terms of, you know, what created that terrain for the bad bacteria to thrive,
right?
You know, cravings of sugar, this kind of a thing, like that's what they feed off of. And if you're throwing, you know, Yara Willard, a friend of mine, he always gives that examples. He's like, it's like throwing yuppies into a ghetto, right? Like they actually don't stand a chance.
Right.
Like
totally,
they're going to put up a fight, but you know, like they're, so unless you're feeding those good guys, like prebiotics, like good fiber-rich foods, whole foods, all that stuff, that's part and parcel. So we got
a question from Raven. What are the symptoms of the die-off, gas and such?
Ah, great question. So Raven, what are the symptoms of die-off that can happen?
Thanks, Raven. So gas, bloating, increase in any kind of chronic health condition that you may have. So if you have a flare-up in symptoms
from arthritis, like
suddenly big swelling in your joints. Eczema is another one. So if you have eczema and you take a whole bunch of fermented foods, you get a flare-up. That's a condition that we associate with it. Asthma. Any kind of flare-up in a chronic health condition, but also it can be things like just generally not feeling very well. So maybe you go out and you have that big glass of kombucha and you start to just feel sort of fatigued and flu-like. You maybe, you know, your stomach just feels upset. Sometimes we can get a bit of a runny nose. all of these sort of symptoms that are just sort of vague and hard to put your finger on can be a symptom that there's too much die-off.
Yeah.
Totally. In kids, sometimes we see it as difficulty sleeping. And when we're doing like a pretty major dietary protocol with kids, sometimes if the die-off is too fast, occasionally you can see some vomiting, and that usually happens at night.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one of the things that can happen. But most commonly, it's just sort of like a general flu-like look and flare-up of symptoms.
Right. Okay.
Hope that answers the question, Raven.
Cool. Yeah. Thanks for your questions. Post them down below. If you're just joining us, we have Deborah Morgan of Kids Health Revolution, one of our local experts, being featured at the Calgary Fermentation Festival happening tomorrow, as well as you're one of our regular instructors here at Light Cellar.
Yeah.
And you've got three classes this season, autumn season here. What are those?
Well, let me reach back into the archives here.
Right? And when are we?
So the first one is the Nourishing Your Child's Brain workshop. So this is all about using gut health and superfoods and things like that to make sure that our kids' brains are getting everything they need. And it's specifically aimed at parents who might have kids with ADHD or autism, and they're wanting to help improve symptoms with those conditions.
Yeah, which we're told, like, here's the medication and away you go. And Deborah can tell you otherwise from her own experience as well as the clients that she's worked with, that can be brought around and improved and even totally reversed.
Major improvements possible, through a few dietary tweaks for sure.
So that's awesome. So we'll post
that. A couple weeks.
We'll post those links down below if that interests you. And there's also, so the second one is?
The second one I think is on eczema and asthma, if I remember correctly. So again, we're talking about how to use nutrition and how to support gut health in a way that will help support those particular conditions, because they're very common in a lot of our kids.
Totally.
And I know I work with a lot of clients who, you know, the steroid creams and the steroid inhalers and all those things just aren't working anymore, and their kids getting sick all the time because they're taking these things. So there's lots of things that you can do as a parent that are going to help to improve your child's symptoms from that, and maybe, you know, decrease the medications they need to take, which would be wonderful, right?
Yeah, totally.
I actually have a question. I'm getting a few people ask on our Facebook about kids' eczema.
Yeah.
And what they can do about it.
Yeah, so they should come to the class.
There you go.
So, but yes, but, you know, very quickly, it's also something that they would learn a little bit about at the Fermentation Festival, but definitely there's a connection between the gut and anything going on in the skin.
Yeah.
So inflammation is enemy number one in any chronic health condition. We know now that it's related to almost all chronic illnesses, and definitely when it comes to the skin. So what we want to do is go in with an anti-inflammatory diet, start addressing those, that balance of what's going on in the gut, and make sure we're taking care of those guys.
Yeah.
And that helps to calm the inflammation in the body and therefore what's happening at the skin level. The skin is just the manifestation of what's going on inside the body.
Yeah, totally.
Right?
All right, cool. So we're going to continue on. We got Deborah Morgan here of Kids Health Revolution, one of our feature instructors at Light Cellar, as well as Calgary Fermentation Festival. We're answering the question, why did ferments make your symptoms worse? So she's answered the first one. There's two reasons, and we're about to dive into the second. So here we go. Reason number two.
Reason number two, drum roll, is histamine intolerance.
Right, histamine intolerance.
Yeah.
This is the big one.
So it is. It's a big one for a lot of people. And when people hear the word histamine, they often think antihistamine, right? That's how we know about histamines, is because we buy antihistamines for seasonal allergies and for allergic reactions and all of these things. So histamine is not a bad thing. We need it. It's actually even a neurotransmitter. It helps with digestion in the gut and in the stomach. So it's absolutely necessary, but often we refer to histamine as being almost like a bucket in the body. So some people's bucket starts to get a little bit too full of the histamine, and then it starts to kind of spill over, and then they get health sort of symptoms from it.
Yeah.
So if you are one of those people, introducing fermented foods into your diet can fill that bucket up a little bit too quickly.
Yeah.
It can be that thing that spills the bucket.
Yeah, or if it's already full and you add those in and...
Right, then you really have an overflow. So again, for those people, you know, if they've gone out and they got their big glass of kombucha or they ate a whole jar of sauerkraut in a day, that bucket's really going to be flowing over and they're not going to feel very well.
No.
Right? So, now the thing with histamine is that there's, we go back to the balance in the gut. So those, having enough of the good guys around and supporting them with the right fiber and things that they need is very important for the histamine picture, because they help create the enzymes that break down histamine in the body.
Right.
So it's not only that we're maybe producing too much, but also that we're not breaking it down as effectively as we could. So oftentimes that's what we see happening. So is there something else that we... Do you have a question about the histamine thing?
No.
Okay. Yeah. I don't want to keep rattling on with not letting you talk.
Right. No, I'll jump in.
Okay, good. So, so what that might look like is, again, the flu-like symptoms. So sometimes it's a little hard to differentiate one from the other, and we'll talk a little bit about, please remind me to circle back to that in a second. But flu-like symptoms is definitely one of the things that you might experience. Runny nose and itchy nose is another one.
Yeah.
Flare-up and eczema is big. Asthma flare-up is another major one, as well as arthritis.
Right.
So those are symptoms or conditions that often go hand in hand with a histamine intolerance.
Right,
So if you have any of those conditions, introducing fermented foods, you need to do it just, again, with that sort of slow mode. Otherwise, you will likely experience... Even dizziness can be
something that... Actually, so I know at least three people now who have Meniere's disease or vertigo.
Yeah.
And eating fermented foods... causes the
skyrockets.
One woman actually came to a fermentation class, and I was chatting with her after the fact. Like, we did it on a Saturday. She loved the class. She was having so much fun. And then Sunday, she was like crippled, like in bed, you know?
Yeah.
Because it just pushed her over the edge.
Right.
And that was a histamine connection there.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah. So, anything to do with any sort of the neurological conditions as well can be something that we need to pay attention to. So if there is autism, or if you have MS or any of these other sorts of conditions, it's not, again, to say, oh my God, I can't have it. Don't be afraid of it. But it's just about going about it in a really sort of practical, step-by-step sort of way, so you're not overwhelming that bucket.
Right, totally. So you would suggest this is a similar approach. So we're talking about the two reasons why your symptoms may get worse by introducing fermented foods. You hear all the hype, oh, this is so great, this is so wonderful. You try it, and it's like, it made me worse.
Yeah.
So Deborah Morgan here, our guest of Kids Health Revolution, featured instructor at Light Cellar and at the Calgary Fermentation Festival, is revealing, giving us insight into what is going on. So first reason was die-off. Second reason is histamines. You know, what to do about it? Are they both similar? It's got to be this kind of slow introduction ingredient.
There's another little piece to the histamine side. So the slow is especially important if you have any of these symptoms. So neurological, eczema, asthma, arthritis, any inflammatory sort of condition, you want to be careful with histamine. So go low and slow, starting with that, just that tiny bit. And I've even worked with clients where we've had to start with a couple of drops of the fermented food juice in water.
Right.
That's where they start.
Yeah.
And they're able to tolerate that. And then we go up to a few more drops, and then it's this progression.
Yeah.
However, if there is a histamine issue, sometimes we need to hold off on having the fermented foods completely until we've done some healing in the gut.
Yeah.
So until we've started to address starving out some of those pathogenic and opportunistic bacteria and getting rid of them that way, and that's going to contribute to your body being able to break down the histamine properly.
Yeah.
And then once some of those things are in place, then you're able to start with that low and slow with the fermented foods.
Right.
So it is occasionally, well, and not even occasionally, it is sometimes the the better approach is to start healing the gut and then slowly start bringing in the ferments and the right. and the good guys.
Yeah, okay, very cool. Any other questions coming in? Feel free to post down below. If you know someone that happened exactly to them, this is valuable, life-changing information. Make sure you give it a share, give it a like, give Deborah a follow at Kids Health Revolution. And then of course, come to the Fermentation Festival. So mm-hmm. you're doing a talk tomorrow called Minding Your Microbiome as well. So you can be part of our expert panel. Whereas during the day, you know, again, 15 different presentations, people have heard a lot, seen a lot. This is a chance for them to kind of like integrate in. Like, okay, right. what about this element? What about that component? Maybe it's a specific question you're already coming in, or it's gonna pop up throughout the day. That'll be a session devoted strictly to that.
You got the prize pack?
Oh yeah, and can't forget about that. We have an amazing prize pack, the ultimate fermentation giveaway. It's worth over $300.
Oh,
we've got a fermentation pot. We have, you know, all the equipment to get you started, all the way from sauerkraut to pickles to water kefir to kombucha.
Beautiful.
It's all in one, it's amazing. And one person is gonna walk away with that. And how does one enter? I think you're probably wondering.
I would like to know that, yeah. yes.
So come to the festival. If you buy a ticket, that is your entry in. Tickets, we've gone through all these different tiers. The first tier was 45, boom, sold out. Second tier was 55, boom, sold out.
Wow.
Third tier, 65. There's literally 17, maybe some sales even come in as we're talking. So it could even be down to like 15 tickets left. So if you've been on the fence, come, you just got to do it. It's going to be a great day to learn, to taste, mm-hmm. to connect, to experience this whole world, and have access to all this knowledge from all these experts.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Great day.
Kelly Cameron says, yay, I've been waiting for this one.
All right. Thanks, all right. Kelly. Yeah, Kelly. Thanks for tuning in. I know we tried to do this this interview
last week.
It didn't work, so really glad we got it in. Hopefully you have benefited from this information or know someone that can benefit. Please give it a share out because it's not uncommon that we, you know, jump into this world, we hear about all the benefits, and then the worst thing, it just makes your symptoms flare up even more. Mm-hmm. But there is a pathway, and someone like Deborah knows that and has just been sharing it. And it is worth taking that time, going the extra mile, because fermented foods are an absolutely essential food group that we need to have in our diet.
Right.
And I guess maybe my last question before we finish here, from my understanding, not all fermented foods contain histamines. A lot of the common ones, like sauerkraut,
right.
Pickles, etc.
Yeah.
But there are some ferments that you can integrate. We're not going to give you the full list here, but are there one or two off the top of your head that you know of that are non-histamine?
Well, the longer it ages, the more histamine it's going to have,
okay.
right? So
yeah,
that's actually something that occurred to me that I meant to say about the histamine is why is there histamine in these foods?
Right.
It's because of the aging process. So any food that you're eating that's aged.
So the 10-year-old miso and the,
right. Even that 30-year-old bottle of red wine maybe you really like is contributing to the histamine, right? So anything that's aged, the cheddar cheeses, all of those things are going to have a certain amount of histamine in them. So for the longer fermentation, the longer it sits and ferments, the longer or the more histamine that it's going to have. So the more reaction it may cause it for you. So usually when we're starting people out on the GAPS diet, we would have them do a GAPS yogurt or a coconut yogurt and one that only ferments for 12 to 24 hours maximum. So you've still got some good guys in there, but you don't have quite as much of the histamine that you're building up on. So that's one of the things that we would do.
That's great. That's that's key. That's essential.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, just one other thing to add to that is that it's so important, you know, when you say it's worth taking the steps, you know, fermented foods used to be part of everybody's life.
Yeah.
And in some cultures still is part of everybody's life. And so they don't have all these problems with it. But because we've gotten so far away from our traditional way of eating and gotten into the standard American diet, which is very sugar heavy.
Yeah.
We've produced this sort of soil in our guts, this territory, this terrain that really favors the pathogenic bacteria, and that leads to all kinds of health problems. So just taking the time to take a few of these steps so that ferments can be part of your life is a huge advantage for your health moving forward.
Totally. The benefits are innumerable, of which you've been hearing, and you'll keep hearing more of it. And worthwhile. So thanks everyone for tuning in. We hope to see you at the festival tomorrow. If not, there are classes here at Light Cellar with Deborah, with myself, to help you on your journey. of health and with fermentation. So thanks again for coming in.
Thank you.
Thanks for presenting tomorrow.
Yeah, I look forward to it. It's going to be fun. Yeah.
All right, right on. Looking forward to meeting everyone in person. And again, continue to post any comments, questions down below. We'll be on there typing away. So,
you bet.
Yeah, we'll see you later. Enjoy your day. All right, thanks for tuning in. Be sure to like this episode, subscribe, as well as share it with someone you know who could benefit from that information. Head over to lightcellar.ca, check out the class calendar. Love to see you at a live event.